we on?
We are on.
Good morning, saints of God.
Good morning.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen.
Amen.
I want to say happy Thanksgiving for those who I have not seen from last Sunday. I pray that all of you had a wonderful and safe Thanksgiving, because this is the new norm. Amen.
Amen.
Zion Travelers Primitive Baptist Church, 1872 Collier Drive, Midfield, Alabama. Sunday, November 29th, 2020, our church announcements. Special thanks to the committee, Sister Lily Moore, Sister Sherry Woods, and Mother Weatherspoon, also assisted by Elder Percy Smiley and Sister Lakeisha McGee. They put together and delivered Thanksgiving baskets to four needy families on Wednesday so that those families could enjoy the Thanksgiving holiday. To God be the glory.
Amen. Amen.
This afternoon at 5 p.m., we will have our Sunset Sunday School Hour. New Sunday School books for December through February quarter have arrived. You can pick up your Sunday School books from the church on any Sunday morning, immediately before or after our 9 a.m. worship period. If you are not receiving Zion Travelers communications and or announcements from the pastor each week, that means that you have not signed up to activate the Remind Announcement System. This system is designed to keep the members of Zion informed. Please contact any member of the church or the pastor to be included. Join us Tuesday morning from 6 a.m. to 6:20 a.m. for our weekly prayer call. The dial-in conference call number and access code will be sent out on the Remind Announcement System. This is not a video call. It is strictly an audio call. Amen?
Amen.
On Wednesday evening at 6:30 p.m., we will have our Zoom online Bible study. We are excited about the response to our online Bible study. We will be studying the book of Ephesians, chapter 6. Please join us and deepen your knowledge and understanding on the use and the study of the Word of God. Invite a couple of friends and our family members to join us for Bible study each week. Happy birthday to everyone born in the month of December.
November.
Thank you. Our birthday wishes go out to Sister Shanquelle Cheatham, Sister Lily Bell Bracey, Sister Carla Young. Also, for the beginning of December, we have Brother Sherrod Blutcher for December 3rd, Brother Robert Petway Sr. for December 5th. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you for giving. As always, the operation and ministry of Zion Travelers cannot exist without your financial support. Our members and any of our friends viewing today's broadcast wishing to contribute by online giving can go to our church website at ztpbc.com and click on Tithe. You can mail in, drop in the church mailbox, or have your bank mail your tithes and offerings to the church at 1872 Collier Drive, Midfield, Alabama, 35228. Remember, the financial responsibilities of the church do continue. Our prayers this morning go out to our mothers and our deacons, also to Brother Brian Peoples and his family. They are the relatives of Sister Julia Crawford, and unfortunately the entire family has been stricken by the COVID virus. Please pray for them because it is a serious condition. Each of you is asked to do your part to expand our ministry. Let us labor together with one mind and one spirit to the glory of God for the spiritual growth and development of Christ's church. Please remember, if everyone in Zion Travelers was like me, what kind of church would Zion Travelers be? Please remember to mask up, wash your hands, stay your distance from one another, and remember that your life is only yours to keep. God bless you.
Amen. We greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Thank God again for this privilege to come together to worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Thank Mother Weatherspoon for those announcements. It is our prayer that everyone had a blessed and a safe Thanksgiving celebration. And we pray that the Lord will continue to smile upon you, give you grace and mercy. As she said at the conclusion, keep you safe in the midst of these conditions that we are living through. Amen. Amen. We thank God for, another day, another Lord's Day that he has given us, that we might come together to worship him in spirit and in truth. Amen. Those of you that have the Christian sword, look with us, if you will, to the Old Testament book of Numbers, chapter 11. Old Testament book of Numbers, chapter 11. And we shall read in your hearing verse number 14. Amen. Reads thusly. I am not able to bear all this people alone because it is too heavy for me. Amen. May the Lord add a blessing. Readers and doers of his word. Amen. We want to share with you from the thought this morning, the work is greater than any one person. The work is greater than any one person. The nature of ministry, serving and meeting the needs of people, requires the involvement and the engagement and the participation of all the people of God. Amen. Jesus said in Matthew 9 and 37 that the harvest is plenteous, but the laborers are few. And he went on there in verse 38 and said, pray ye the Lord of the harvest that he'll send laborers into his vineyard. Amen. 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 The work is greater than any one person. Amen. I want to draw your attention to this text today. Find the children of Israel in the wilderness, and amen, after all of their food that they had brought out of Egypt had run out, amen, the Lord made provision for them by feeding them with manna that he dropped down from heaven each day. Amen. And as those of you that are students of the word know, on the sixth day, he would give them a double portion than last for that Sabbath day. But God shows us, amen, in so many ways that he provides for us. But the backdrop of this text actually deals with people that were living and walking, though they were blessed by God, they did not understand really how the faith to trust God in the midst of all circumstances. Now, let me break that down, what I mean by that. Amen. When we trust God, amen, when life brings us struggles, when life brings challenges and problems our way, as life will, amen, when we've had one experience with God, and God delivers us, God brings us through, God makes a way for us, it ought to give us confidence. So when we run to the next trial or storm or obstacle, it ought to give us faith and confidence that, well, if God provided once, he'll do it again. But sometimes, like Israel in our text here, we fail the text. Sometimes we fall short of, amen, of standing on the kind of faith that the Lord, amen, require us to have. I recall Jesus said, amen, at one point, if we had faith just the size of a mustard seed, not a whole lot, not a gigantic amount, but just the size of a mustard seed, we can move the mountains in our lives. But here, amen, Israel was in the wilderness. How many know life can give us a lot of wilderness experiences? Life can lead us in territories that we are unfamiliar with. Life can, take us into circumstances where we are out of our comfort zone, all of the common creature comforts that we are used to and accustomed to, by the grace and the blessings of God, where we are removed from them, which gives us an opportunity to be a little bit reflective and focus on how good God is and how God constantly provides for us and for his people. But in the text, we find that God had provided manna from on high for them. The first thing we see as we look at this text is the demand of ministry. The demand of ministry. God provided them manna, and after a while they got tired. You know how we are. Some of us today even don't want to eat any leftovers, huh? Oh, yeah, but if we eat it once or twice or three times, we're really ready for something else. And now, here, this text, when you look at this text, it reminds us we got to be careful the company we keep. We got to be careful who we allow to influence us. Because as we study the text, what we find is that when God delivered the children of Israel out of Egyptian bondage, they also brought some non-Hebrews with them that accompanied them. And these were not Hebrews. They were foreigners, as they would be referred to. They did not know the promise of God, nor did they know God himself. And we've got to be careful, when we intertwine with folks that don't know God. Did not the word make the declaration? Jesus said himself, two cannot walk together unless they agree. And so, they allowed them, they were the first that started to complain. The demands of ministry. They begin to complain. Now, there's nothing wrong with going to God and saying, Lord, I thank you for what you've done. And Master, if it's not too much, if I'm not coming to ground across ungrateful, I'd like to make an additional request. If it be according to your will and your grace. You see, it's not always what we do, but how we do it. The Bible tells us to come boldly before the throne of grace. We ought to do that. But we need to know how to go about doing it. But not once when you read the text do you see where they said to the Lord, thank you for what you've already done. Thank you for the bread, but I want some meat. No. The text says that they got tired of eating, the diet of eating the bread. Well, first of all, let's look at the basic, scientific anatomy of it. First of all, when you're hungry and you eat something, whether it's steak or whether it's caviar, or whether peanut butter and jelly, when your stomach gets full, guess what? All it knows is that the food, it does not care, what filled it up. So we must be grateful, but they got tired of eating manna day in and day out. See, they had already forgotten about how when their food had ran out and they didn't have nothing, they went to Moses complaining. So they go crying, complaining and moaning to the Lord. Now, the demand was that we want something more than we already have. You know, I've discovered God don't need to give us more when we can't handle what we already got. When we don't appreciate what we already have, why should he give us more? If we're not being a good steward, if we're wasting that which he's entrusting into us, why should he have more for us to waste? If we're hoarding and holding everything and not sharing with anybody, why should he give us more to hoard? Amen. Because at the end of the day, Brother Solomon the preacher said, amen, we can heap up all kinds of goods and wealth, but at the end of the day, when we die, we're going to leave it behind to somebody else. And we don't know whether they'll fall into wise or foolish hands.
You're right.
But here, amen, they begin to make demands. Amen. On Moses and on the Lord. Amen. Amen. Now understand as a nation and as people of God, as a ministry of Christ, demands are expected. They're reasonable as we, go about doing the work and the will of God. As a matter of fact, if you look at that, Acts chapter 6, in the early, in the infancy of the church, when it began to grow and multiply so fast and so numerous, they appointed deacons because it was too much work for the apostles to handle. And they said, well, we'll set us aside 7 men and appoint them over this work so we can keep focus on ministering the word of God. Amen. So demands are normal and natural. Amen. And it's an outgrowth. Then there are demands, and sometimes we need to do a bit of an analysis on the church. Amen. Especially in our particular age group, especially during the time in which we are living, where we're going through all kinds of transition and changes and trying, to do the work and the will of God and meet the needs of people of a wide variety of categories. For instance, think about it. The church. Amen. It deals overall with about 6 different generations.
All right.
It deals with the baby boomers, those between somewhere between 46 and 64. The Generation Jones, they're called, that was born between 55 and 65. The Generation X's. Born between 65 and 1980. The millennials, born between 1981 and 96. Generation Z's that were born, 1997 or later. Then you've got now what's called Generation Alpha, born between from 2010 and forward. Then there's also that generation that's called the traditionalist or the silent generation that was born before 1945.
All right.
I'm the church. I see ministers to the body of Christ has to strive to try to meet the needs of everybody from one generation to the next.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. You think the needs of a 15-year-old going to be the same as a 90-year-old? That means as we labor, as we try to meet the demands, their ministries, the things that we do that will be targeted for various groups at various times, everything won't be for everybody, but somebody will find something in all the ministry that the church does. And the demands are ever growing. On top of that, because of this pandemic, I think I heard Mother Weatherspoon said during the announcement we're headed toward a new norm. Can I share, the struggles that the body of Christ is in right now? Amen, and really drives us to the next point in our text. Amen. Not only the demands of the ministry, but the weight of the ministry. I've talked with countless pastors during this pandemic. You know what the biggest concern of most pastors? What's going to happen to the body of Christ once the pandemic is over? I'm not stuck. I'm letting it sink in. You see, it's been, what, 8 months now, headed toward 9 months we've been in this pandemic. And we've developed the creature comforts. Amen. The Lord's day is now our day, really. Amen. Partly because for a while there was nothing else we could do. But we got into the comfort zone, and don't misunderstand me. During this pandemic, we thank God for it, because if we didn't have this medium, amen, whether it's Facebook Live or Zoom or YouTube or whatever mechanism, we'd have no mechanism to utilize, and we will continue to use it into what we call the new normal. But here's the fear that every pastor has. When the pandemic is over, are we going to remain on our couches,
all right,
waiting for it to come on? Are we going to come back and assemble together? Now, let me hasten to say, amen, the old adage, you know, the necessity, it drives the invention. It's true. We're doing what we're doing now out of necessity, but what happens when we need to come back to normal? Because right now we're in a temporary state. You see, there are some things, amen, that we cannot get unless we come together. When the Lord said to us in Hebrew 10, 23, 4, and 5, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together, he did that because there are some things that are necessary to help encourage us, strengthen us, and provoke us to keep going the work and will of God and keep pressing forward in this thing that we call life. Sometimes we need to be able to look on one another's face, be able to touch and give some encouragement along the way. So the weight of the work can get heavy. Amen, amen. Look in the text. Because Israel did not turn to God in prayer and ask God, amen, to bless them with more than bread. Amen. The text says they began to moan. Look at verse number 5. They said to the Lord, they said to Moses, we remember when we were in Egypt. We remember the fish, the flesh pot. We remember the cucumbers and melons and leek and the onions and garlic. We remember the good stuff we had in Egypt. Part of the, amen, weight of the ministry is when the people are looking reflectively at the past rather than dealing with the present and looking toward the future. Have you ever thought about it? When you get behind your automobile, at the steering wheel of your automobile, have you noticed the size of the windshield versus the size of the rearview mirror? Huh? You think that's by accident? You think that's by chance? No, not at all. It's important to know what's happening at times behind you. But what's most important, what's most urgent, amen, is what's happening in front, what's both imminently before you and in the long view ahead, that you might safely navigate through whatever is in front of you. But it's a strange thing, even in the midst of, amen, hardship, we forget about the pain and the suffering and go only to the things that made us feel good. they forgot about all of the 430 years of the hard labor, all of the time when they were crying out to the Lord, amen, about the oppression, all about the struggles, all about the heartaches and the hard taskmasters, amen, they forgot about that. So we got to be careful. Our memories can deceive us sometimes.
Yes, sir.
Because it can be very selective. And I've discovered that, amen, it's not so hard to get people out of Egypt. Huh? But where the difficulty is, where the challenge is, where the hardship is to get Egypt out of people. And so, looking back, because they were in what they considered a point of dissatisfaction, they said, "I remember how good we had it in Egypt." The text says that God was displeased, and so was Moses. To the extent that Moses said to the Lord in verse number 11, "Lord, why have you put this weight on me? Why have you afflicted me this way?" Can I be real for a moment? In order to understand where Moses was coming from, I have to have an insight on the nature of ministry. You see, the nature of ministry, amen, is that we labor one with another. We share in one another's struggles. We share in their problems. We share in their celebration and their joys. Or to say it the way it was said in the New Testament, we rejoice with those that rejoice. We weep with those that weep. In other words, amen, as we are laboring to encourage and strengthen and support, we invest ourselves in others. That's what true ministry is all about, and so we carry the burdens. Note how many times in the Old Testament the prophet said the burden of the word of the Lord to his people. It's simply because there's a weight that goes along with it. There's a weight when, amen, we are trying to encourage others, amen, to go God's way, because we see, amen, the hardships and the struggles that they are going through and trying to handle by themselves, and trying to get them to surrender it to the Lord, amen, and they keep holding on to it for dear life, amen, and we carry the word. Burden. And so Moses says to God, "Lord, why did you put this weight, this burden of the people upon me?" He said in another passage, he said to the Lord, "You know, Lord, I was over there minding my own business, taking care of Jethro's sheep. I was content, huh? I was satisfied, and you came and got me and told me to lead your people." But see, true leadership is investing of self-sacrificing for the benefit of others, but it carries a certain burden, and it carries a certain weight. And at this point, amen, Moses was experiencing, amen, the full weight of the circumstances on him. And he said to him, "Lord, I'm carrying them all on my shoulder."
Yeah.
And then he says to the Lord in verse 14, "I'm not able to bear these people alone. I'm not able to bear the weight alone. They are too heavy for me." And Moses was right. If we go back to amen, when Moses was handling the nation of Israel and all of the problems, remember his father-in-law Jethro came to him and told him that the weight is too heavy for you. You can't bear it all. It's not good for you. It's not good for the people. He said that, Lord, it's too heavy for me to bear. And let me see if I can get you to appreciate the gravity of what Moses was feeling at this point in time. He says in verse 15, Moses says, Lord, if you're going to deal with me this way, I pray that you just go ahead and kill me off. If I found favor in thy sight, go ahead and kill me off and let me not see where I fall so far of your glory. Now, let me hasten to say, Moses was responding, amen, as we respond many times in our carnal flesh, we're responding to the weight of the situation. He was not in any way saying to the Lord that I'm ready to die, but he's just saying the weight is so heavy that I feel like it would be better off if you took me on away. But I'm glad that though the demands of the ministry are great and though the weight gets heavy, amen, God made provision, amen, that through a unified spirit, we can accomplish the ministry. God says to Moses, Moses, I know your problem. I know what you're struggling with. I know what you're dealing with. I know that the load is heavy. So Moses, here's my instruction to you. You look out on the leaders of the tribes of Israel, and you choose out 70 men.
Yeah.
Amen. Who are leaders in their tribes, and we're going to set them aside. Amen. That they might be there with you, that they might undergird and take on some of the load. Amen. Let me bring it to modern day and time. Amen. Amen. Moses, I'm going to give you somebody that will call and check on other members to make sure they're all right. Moses, I'm going to give you somebody, amen, that will pray for the whole body. I'll give you somebody that will not only pray for you, but pray for the deacon, pray for the mother, mothers of the children. I'm going to give you somebody that will be willing to get on Sunday school on Sunday afternoon, get on the prayer line 6 o'clock on Tuesday morning. I'll give you somebody willing to get on the Bible study over Zoom on Wednesday evening.
Yeah. Amen.
It's too much for one person. You see, everybody in the body of Christ have a circle of influence. You got people that you come into contact, people that you encounter from day to day, people that God gives you the opportunity to minister to. Amen. But you got to be equipped in order, amen, to minister.
All right.
Amen. You can't serve anything if you don't have anything to serve up. So God said to Moses, I'm going to get take these 70 people. And the text said he had them to encamp, these 70 to a camp around the tabernacle. Amen. And the Lord told Moses, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take your spirit. Amen. Because you can't, lead if everybody's leading in their own way. Amen. All through his writing in the New Testament, Paul kept saying to us, be of one mind, be on one accord, be in one spirit, operate in unity. And so he said, I'm going to take your spirit, Moses, and I'm going to put it in, amen, the heart of the 70. Amen. And Moses, I want you to let the people know, amen, that I'm going to give them what they ask for. Amen. I'm going to give them what they ask for to the point that they're going to be sick and tired of it. Amen. Amen. But in the midst of it, God is demonstrating to the children of Israel that he is God. Amen. Amen. And as I prepare, I'm going to leave you alone today. I want to remind you that this work, amen, of spreading the gospel, this work, amen, of operating the body of Christ is greater than any one person. It takes everybody doing their part in order for the work to go forward. Amen. I heard Paul talk about, amen, the different components and parts of the body and how every part need to do its part in order for the body to operate in a proper manner in an orderly fashion. And good God Almighty, amen, the Bible says, amen, that the harvest, the work is plenteous, but the labor is a few. I wonder today, how many under the sound of my voice today will recommit and rededicate yourself for doing the work of God, even though we can't all come together in one meeting place. There are those that are around you need now more than ever a word of encouragement. They need to know that serving God is real. They need to know that he is a source of help and a source of strength. They need to know that they don't have to try to make it through this life all by themselves. They need to know, amen, that there is somebody you can point them to that will be with them, that will walk with them, that will comfort them, that will reassure them, that will help them through this thing that we call life. Amen. The children of Israel in this text was in the wilderness right now in the midst of this pandemic. Many people saved and unsaved are in the wilderness and they need somebody to give them some spiritual guidance. They need somebody to give them some hope and reassurance. They need somebody to tell them that if they look to the Lord, he will see them through. They may be in the valley right now, but if they look up and look out on Jesus, he will help them. Anybody know today that the Lord will help you? Anybody today ever called on the name of the Lord? I'm kind of like the choir. I sing the song. I called on the Lord and got an answer. I don't know about you, but there have been times over and over again I've called on the Lord, and I'm glad I can testify. I'm glad I can witness. We serve a prayer-answering God. We serve an ever-present God. We serve a God who is able. Do you know he's able? Do you know he's able? Has the Lord ever done anything in your life? Good God Almighty, can you testify? Can you testify? There is one. greater than you. I'm kind of like John the Baptist was when Jesus came to be baptized. John said, no, I'm not worthy. I need to be baptized with you. Jesus said, I have to suffer it to be so. I must fulfill all righteousness. Like John the Baptist, I'm so glad I can tell the world there is he is the one. He's the one. I'm not the one, but I just came to let men know that he is a savior and he's sweet. I know. Do you know him? Do you know him? Any way maker? Isn't he a good God Almighty? Way out of no way. I'm so glad. I'm so glad. When the weight gets heavy, when the road gets dark, Jesus, do you know him? Jesus, my darling friend, Jesus, God Almighty, he will come and see about you. I'm so glad, when the work was too heavy and we had no hope. Jesus, God darling son, came down, didn't he do it through 40 and two generations? Stopped off in a little city called Bethlehem. Didn't he do it? Good God Almighty. 8 days old, he was circumcised. 12 years old, found in the temple. 30 years old, baptized in Jordan River. 3.5 years, walked this dusty earth, healing the sick, raising the dead, giving sight to the blind. Do you know him? Do you know him? Have you tried him? Is he all right? Is he all right? He's all right, I tell you. When nothing else would help, my Lord, your Savior, my leaning post, your walking cane, my doctor, your lawyer, my company keeper, your midnight rider, Jesus, took a cross on his shoulder. Went to a hill called Calvary. They stretched him wide, hung him high, shedded his cleansing blood for your sin, my sin, sin of the world. Didn't he do it? Didn't he do it? When he paid a full debt of sin, hung his head in the locks of his shoulder, gave up the ghost, that's into his shoulder at the foot of the cross. Quite surely, surely, this must be the Son of God. I'm glad that was just amen, a semicolon. It wasn't over. Laid my Lord and your Savior in a borrowed grave 3 days, 3 nights. But early, early, anybody know what I'm talking about? Early, that third day morning, Friday had passed, Saturday had passed, but early Sunday morning, my Savior, my Lily of the Valley, my bright and morning star, my King of Kings, my Lord of Lords, I got up out of the grave, all power in his hand, all power in his hand. That power that he gives to all believers to go about doing his Father's business. Power to witness, power to testify, power to share the rightly divided word of God. All power is in his hand. Let us pray. Gracious Father, we come now to the altar humbly yet boldly as instructed in thy word. Come with thanksgiving, humble at your divine presence. As we look upon your holiness, Father, we ask you to forgive us our sins, for there are many. Thank you for your grace and mercy, O God. Thank you for forgiveness, and thank you for all of the blessings that you bestow upon us. Now, Lord, somebody under the sound of my voice right now, God, is struggling, maybe in the same position that Israel was in. They have, my father, all but given up. They've been beaten down by the conditions and circumstances of life. Oh, Lord, even now, speak to their heart, mind, and soul. Let them know, God, there is a more excellent way. Oh, Father, help them to look now to the hill for which cometh all of our help. And, oh, Lord, let them speak to you out of their heart. Let them ask your son Jesus to be the Lord of their life, to forgive them and wash away their sin. Even now, Lord, touch their hearts. Give them a newness of life, a new way of walking and living through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Now, Lord, we thank you for all of the blessings that you bestow upon us each and every day. Too numerous to count, my Father, but none that we can take for granted, but we simply say thank you. We acknowledge that we're not deserving, but our heart overflowing with gratitude, my Father, for your goodness, for your faithfulness toward us. And now, Lord, we ask that thou would speak to the heart of all of our people. Give encouragement, my Father, where they need encouragement. Those that are sick, those that are struggling with COVID and cancer and whatever diseases that are binding, oh God, we ask that thou would loose them right now and give deliverance that only thou can do. Pray for those in the hospitals and nursing homes, those, my Father, wherever they may be right now. Oh Lord, we ask that thou would reveal yourself to them, that they might be healed, that they might be strengthened, that they might be delivered, that they might come to know you, who is our all in all. We ask all these blessings in thy son's name. We ask them according to thy will and to thy divine glory. We do pray. Amen. 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 May God bless you. May heaven smile upon you. If there's any out there that don't know the Lord, we invite you to accept Christ now as your personal Savior. He's waiting for you. He is the I Am God. He's able to deliver you and bring you through whatever you're struggling with. We invite you to make your way to Zion Travelers or any church that the Lord put in your heart, because we're concerned about your soul and in your walk and relationship with Christ. Amen. Amen. May God bless you.